longtime WDSU icon Alec Gifford, who sadly passed away on Friday. He will be remembered fondly by everyone here at WDSU. We are joined now live with a couple of people you might recognize, people who work very closely with Alec Gifford over the years. Joining us to talk about his legacy, we have WDSU news anchor Norman Robinson, and joining us, former WDSU investigative reporter Richard Angelico. Gentlemen, needless to say, we have lost a treasure.
No question about it. Alec Gifford was one of a kind.
Yeah.
You know, there's nothing that you can say about Alec Gifford that hadn't been said already by his many viewers, his many admirers all over the city and all over the country, for that matter. Alec was a known commodity.
Absolutely. No one knows that better than you, Richard. You've been knowing Alec since 1969, actually before that.
Right.
Tell us about that.
He was a member of my church, and he hired me in 1969 when I came in one day and I just said, I'd like to be a TV reporter. It looks like fun. And he handed me a handful of clippings from the newspaper that he always had sticking out of pockets and briefcases and everywhere else. He said, here, write this for TV. And I was like,
just that simple.
Okay. So I wrote it. God knows what I wrote. I don't even remember. I rewrote it. He said, that's good. That's good. Alec always talked like that. You know?
Yeah.
Yep, real clip.
You know? You're right.
He was, yeah, that adrenaline was always there. Alec was never a type A. He was a type AAA.
Mm-hmm.
And he was always on, you know.
Yeah.
He was just an amazing guy. And so he said, okay, you're right. That's good. Tell you what. You're going to produce the 11 p.m. news for me. I went, I am. So I was hired as a producer writer.
Mm-hmm.
Show me how to back time the show, and Jim Kemp said, here's how you do this and that, and boom, boom, and there I was producing the 11 p.m. newscast. You know, and it was just incredible. I mean, there's no way in the world that could happen nowadays. You know?
Oh, not at all. Not in the least bit.
That's the thing about Alec. Alec had an eye for talent.
Yeah.
He really did.
Are you saying that because
because he hired me. I think he was a collector of people, and he always believed in a diversity of people, because he believed that that the best kind of stories came from people with different backgrounds,
mm-hmm.
and people with different interests, and people who could bring a different dynamic or a different flavor to the newsroom. I can remember that Alec was always experimenting with this thing that we call journalism, and that he insisted that we touched every part of the profession. He would bring reporters in and let reporters produce newscasts. Richie was talking about it.
Yeah.
Just, you know, you're going to be my 11 o'clock producer. He would make sure that you knew everything there was to know about any particular aspect or phase of the business that
you were in.
Which is great. Because he believed that if you were going to be a professional journalist, mm-hmm. then you should know everything there was to know about the field that you were engaged in. And he made sure that if you were on his watch, a member of his staff, you in fact were going to know everything there was to know, whether you liked it or not.
Mm-hmm.
Because one day we came in and he said, okay, you're going to produce today and the producers are going to report. That's how
the producers are going to report.
Absolutely. The reporters
wow.
are going to produce the newscast and the producers are going to report for the newscast.
Cross-training.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
He made sure that you understood everybody's role. So you would appreciate the effort that it took to do the job.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just an incredible ride with Alec. And everything was an exciting adventure with him.
Wow.
Everything. The most mundane, the most trivial thing was the most exciting thing that you could possibly ever do in your lifetime.
And
it was Alec's world.
He loved it. He loved what he did. I only had the pleasure of working with him for a few months. He left at the end of 2006. Yeah. I came here April 2006. But he loved it. You could tell, as you put it, quintessential newsman.
He lived, breathed
news.
And he not only the news people, the journalists, but you know, he took me aside a few times and
really?
Told me a few things as well. And Meg, one of the first things that Meg told me when I started here was the same thing that Alec told her. And she told me, you need some Tabasco. You need to spice it up a little
bit. All right.
I got it, Meg.
Right. Words
words of wisdom.
One of the things Alec did when he came back from New York, and he went to, of course, to Channel 8 at that time, mm-hmm. and but he brought back this concept from New York that was foreign to the market down here, and that was doing packages. You know, we do that as a matter of routine now. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, we'll make a package out of anything. Yeah, what? We'll make three packages out of it. But, and, but what we used to do, what, inside joke, but what we used to do was you just have voiceovers, you know, mm-hmm. And we'd shoot film and you'd voice, the anchor would voice over the film and that'd be it. And Alec insisted that we do packages just like they did at Network. And oh my God, the resistance of that, the photography staff and everybody thought he was, you know, the veterans that were in place thought he was absolutely lost his mind. And but he, you know, he changed the entire concept of doing local news, and so we started doing packages, and you know, within a matter of a month, everybody was doing them in town.
Yeah, he was definitely an innovator. I remember May 3rd, 1978, before electronic engineering, before mm-hmm. microwave, before the live shot.
Yeah,
he engineered and confected a live show right there. In front of the station, we were at WVUE at the time. He was news director, and he came in. That was the first flood. I remember May 3rd, 1978, when the city and most of the region was underwater mm-hmm. because we had that torrential downfall. Alec took the studio cameras out of the studio into the streets and decided he was going to do a live newscast. Mm-hmm. On location. It was a riot. and Nash Roberts was the meteorologist at the time. He said, good luck, gentlemen. You all are nuts.
Well, he did the same thing during the Howard Johnson shootout. You know, when I got down there and, you know, it was a fire. It was called out as a fire. And when we got down there, all of a sudden we realized there was a sniper in the building and police officers and firemen were dropping left and right. And Alec rolled one of these large cameras out into the parking lot. We were on Cleveland Avenue at the time, and you could see the Howard Johnsons from this little back parking area. Had the camera out there, and somebody saw Alec out there. This guy was a welder, and he brought down a 4x8 sheet of steel or iron and put it up behind the camera, and Alec was there just in case some stray rounds came flying through, you know, and he was giving a blow-by-blow about what was going on, and we had film back then, so we'd shoot. Most of us were crawling around under automobiles with Wallensack tape recorders, and the cameraman John Landry had a Bell and Howell 8mm camera, and he also had a blue police jacket on, and he was hard of hearing. He ran across the parking lot. Police was shooting at John, mm-hmm. but we relayed the film back to the TV station, and they put it in the tank. And as the film came out of the tank, there was no editing or anything. It all went on TV live, and Alec just started narrating over all the film. We did that for 3 days.
He had the gift.
Oh,
wow.
No, he did.
He
no
had the gift, and we could go.
He was born to do it.
Yeah, and loved doing it every second. We could go on and on, but the bottom line is Alec Gifford was a teacher. Mm-hmm. He was a leader. Mm-hmm. And most of all, he was our friend.